The Act does not require a person to give reasons as to why he requires the information which has been applied for. The Act also does not require the applicant to disclose his locus for trying to seek the information. Section 4 of the Act casts an obligation on all public authorities to duly maintain all the records suo moto, put up as much information as possible and practicable in public domain. Section 8 says that the government with the power has power to place reasonable restrictions on the right to information. It provides for exemption from disclosure of information in cases where disclosure would prejudicially affect the sovereignty and security or economic interests of the state, relation with foreign state, or lead to incitement of an offense, information which has been expressly forbidden by some law, then information disclosure of which would cause a breach of privilege of parliament or the state legislature, cabinet papers, privacy, confidentiality, etc. Section 18 grants wide powers and functions to the information commissions in respect of the implementation of the Act. Section 20 grants the information commissions to the power to levy penalties on government departments in cases where there is a breach of the mandate of the Act. If there is a delay and there is no justification, the information commissioner is obliged to impose a fine at the rate of ₹250. There is no discretion left to the commission. He has to simply decide whether there is an unjustified delay and impose the penalty in accordance with the provisions of the Act. Then Section 25 grants the power of monitoring and reporting to the commissions with regard to the implementation of the Act. Presently, the appointment to the information commissioners is governed by Section 12 and 15 of the Right to Information Act. The qualifications for the appointment are that the Chief Information Commissioner and Information Commissioners shall be persons of eminence in public life with wide knowledge and experience in law, science and technology, social service, management, journalism, mass media or administration and governance. There is no doubt that the present system of appointment, I am not talking about the provision, but I am talking about the system of appointment, is not very satisfactory. And the general complaint of the public is that this system is not transparent, A, and mostly the bureaucrats, either serving bureaucrats or the retired bureaucrats, are nominated as commissioners. Now let us come to the judgment of the Supreme Court. Now this judgment was delivered by Justice Swatantra Kumar and Justice A.K. Patnaik with regard to the appointment of information commissioners. The judgment was passed in public interest litigation filed by Namit Sharma, challenging the constitutional validity of Section 12 and 15 of the Act. I will, instead of summarizing the operative part of the judgment, I will just read that in order you will immediately appreciate what is the direction by the court. I will read that relevant portion. We are of the considered view that it is an unquestionable proposition of law that the Commission is a judicial tribunal performing functions of a judicial as well as quasi-judicial nature and having the trappings of a court. It is important cog and is part of the court's attached system of administration of justice, unlike a ministerial tribunal which is more influenced and controlled and performs functions akin to the machinery of administration. It will be just, fair and proper that the first appellate authority, that's not commissioner, commissioner is the second appellate authority. The first appellate authority, that is the senior officers to be nominated in terms of Section 5 of the Act of 2005. Preferably should be the persons possessing a degree in law or having adequate knowledge and experience in the field of law. The information commissions at the respective levels shall henceforth work in benches of two members each, one of them being a judicial member while the other an expert member. The judicial member should be a person possessing a degree in law, having a judicially trained mind and experience in performing judicial functions. A law officer or a lawyer may also be eligible, provided he is a person who has practiced law at least for a period of 20 years as on the date of the advertisement. Such a lawyer should have experience in social work. We are of the considered view that the competent authority should prefer a person who is or has been a judge of the High Court for appointment as information commissioners, chief information commissioner at the center or state level shall only be a person who is or has been a chief justice of the High Court or a judge of the Supreme Court of India. In short, all these information commissions should deal with these information applications or the appeals in benches. One member has to be judicial member. Preference should be given to the retired High Court judges, and the chief information commissioner has to be a retired chief justice or a retired Supreme Court judge. So this is the judgment in short. Now, this is on the hypothesis that the information commission exercises adjudicatory powers of a nature no different than a judicial tribunal and is also vested with the powers of the civil court. Now, the powers of the civil court which are vested in the commission are very limited, like summoning a witness, administrating oath, etc. It is not a civil court by any stretch of imagination. The judgment has completely overlooked the fact that the RTI Act 2005 has been enacted to provide a practical regime of right to information for citizens to secure access to information under the control of public authorities as per the preamble of the RTI Act. Although the Information Commission deals with some legal issues, but the number of such cases will be negligible, the mere fact that these legal issues are decided does not make it a judicial body. You see, information is sought about some person, and the defense is that it's a privacy right is pleaded in defense. So the commissioner has to decide whether this is a privacy related aspect and whether there is a overriding public interest. So these issues, determination of these issues will not make this particular commission a judicial tribunal. The commission does not dispense justice. It merely deals with the disclosure of information. The information is already in control of the public authorities, which they can, by executive order, disclose to the citizens. Therefore, the only issue to be decided is whether the information which is already available with the authorities should be disclosed or not. Therefore, equating the information commissions with a judicial tribunal is completely erroneous. Then we go to the second point, about the qualifications. The Supreme Court said that it is vague, the expressions knowledge and experience appearing would mean only a basic degree in the respective field. The terminology used as mass media or administration of governance are terms of uncertain tenor and amplitude. Thus, for speedy justice, uniformity of approach, predictability of decisions, and specialist justice, the Information Commission should be manned by persons with judicial experience. And the kind of duties and responsibilities that such high post is expected to perform can be done only by a legally trained mind more efficaciously. However, in adopting this line of approach, the Supreme Court has completely rewritten the provision of Section 12 and 15 of the Act. It is not for the courts to spell out what ought to be the qualifications or experience for appointment to a particular post. This is, in my respectful opinion, this is a clear case of judicial overreach where the court virtually legislated the provisions of law. Now, surprisingly, if you go through the judgment, with greatest respect to the honorable judges, there are self-contradictory findings. In one paragraph, it says that the provisions are vague, uncertain, and therefore it almost indicates that they are not valid. In the very next paragraph, it says that the provisions are not violative of Article 14. And then it says that no, you have to read in something. Ordinarily, in order to sustain the constitutional validity of a provision, the court might adopt the principle doctrine known as reading down the law. So you read down the law so that it doesn't offend the provisions of the constitution. So here the court says no, it is reading in. And what is read in? That all members should be bench of one judicial member, only the chief justice should be the, or Supreme Court judge should be retired, Supreme Court judge should be the commissioner, etc. And what is most surprising is the Supreme Court has referred to international practices of information commissions in several nations. Not one nation, not in one nation, the commissions are manned by judges. If you go through the judgment, you'll find that there is one reference where the solicitors or lawyers are prepared for the post of it, not judges. The court has made a lengthy discussion on the administrative tribunals principles in UK, but those it's completely disregarding the fact that the information commissions in UK are not manned by my judges. So we have set absolutely unique precedent, and we say that it should be only by judges. Now see the consequences of the judgment. Now it is completely unclear whether what would happen to the present commissions. Till the time judicial experts are appointed, the number of second appeals pending with the information commission would rise by huge number. The Central Information Commission, I am taking only one commission, has 11 posts, none of which is held by a member with a judicial background. 3 posts are vacant. For the commission to work in benches of 2, it has to have at least 12 members. Of the 12, 6 have to be judicial members, which means a minimum of 2 of the existing members have to be replaced. But this is not easy. How can you remove an information commissioner? If the ruling can come into effect only after those members retire, then what would happen in the interim? So that is also not clear. And the most important aspect is when you say that they must function in benches, it means that there will be only 6 outlets in the Central Information Commission instead of 12, because they can sit singly in respect of most of the inquiry applications are routine applications, and this can be dealt with by single judges. And currently, I'm afraid of another thing. We are, I do not wish to blame the lawyers. I take the blame only on the judges. But we have cultivated the culture of adjournments and complex legalities, and that all this legalism will be brought in an information commission, which is supposed to be a practical regime giving immediate relief to the citizens who are seeking information. Today the rates of adjournment is only 1%. I'm not sure what will happen once the judges are made part of that. And then today the pendency has gone up to 20,000. So with this judgment, which has practically paralyzed some of the information commissions, and when they start working in benches, and when you work in benches, it means it inevitably there has to be deliberation between 2 members. So it is going to take more time, and the arrears would increase. My perception is that with this interjection by the Supreme Court, it might take 3 to 5 years to decide a information commission appeal, and the people will lose interest in the information. Today, it is the nation. It has caught the imagination of the nation. So I'm really surprised that this judgment has come, and this is supposed to be the benefit of the people. Now the greatest infirmity that this judgment seems to suffer is that it is readily crosses in the realm of legislation when the same should have been avoided at all costs. Despite the judgment elaborating in great detail that the court should be cautious while entering the realm of legislation and testing the constitutional validity of statute, yet the court seems to have compromised the theory of separation of powers blatantly. This is a clear case of judicial overreach and transgression into legislative privilege. Now, what is the track record of the judiciary when it comes to the information, releasing of information? See, in every issue, let us look at it with a practical point of view. In every issue, the final word and ultimate interpretation of a controversy lies with the court. The issue of right to information is not an exception, so every issue under the Right to Information Act is finally, wherever it is contested, is going to land in the court. Now there is a complaint, I have heard it from several people, that repeatedly the judgments are stayed, the matters are not decided early, the locus standi of the Information Commission is questioned. It is said that the Information Commission cannot appear in the matter. Maybe that's a legal position, but the net effect is that many issues are still pending in the The classic example is the one judge of Madras High Court wrote a letter to the CJI with the name of the minister that the that he has tried to influence him. He came through with a telephone conversation. So the then CJI said that no, there is no such complaint. The judge has not named the minister. Ultimately, in some contempt proceeding, it turned out that the minister, the judge has really named the minister. So the there was a RTI inquiry by Mr. Subhash Chandra Agarwal, and then it is that issue is directly an appeal is filed in the Supreme Court and it is pending. In Subhash Chandra Agarwal's case, that is against the whether the CJI comes under the Right to Information Act, the only question which was raised was whether the judges have disclosed the information about their assets to the Chief Justice of their High Court or the Chief Justice of India, wherever there is a Supreme Court judge involved. So that information is denied, only simple information which ought not to have been denied. So it came before Delhi High Court. Delhi High Court rejected it. Delhi High Court tried to expand Right to Information Act. It says that it's not only Right 19(1)(a), but it is also Article 14 or Article 21. I might apply for information not necessarily to speak, but I want to know whether the wages are paid to the Narega workers or not. So it's not about the right to speak, but it is about the discrimination. So it is implicit, it is also situated under Article 14. 21 also, because when you talk of the, when you question about the judge's appointment or such thing, it is about the rule of law. So it is about Article 21, it is not about Article 91A alone. So anyway, the result is that the then Chief Justice of India, Justice Balakrishnan, said that he wrote to the Prime Minister that the CJI should be exempt from the provisions of the Right to Information Act. He also suggested that the decision of the Registrar General should be final, and it is only the CJI would decide which information should be released or not. So I feel that the judiciary should first welcome the application of the RTI. First Delhi High Court framed the rules, and you will be surprised to know that the rules provide that all information will be given, but it will be only about the judicial work, and no information will be given in respect of financial and administrative matters. Then it is said that I think 15 rupees is the cost for the making an application. The Delhi High Court said it should be 500. So the penalties, maximum penalty is 25,000. Delhi High Court says it can be only 500 rupees if the information is not disclosed. So I had an occasion to amend that rules, intervene there, and they ultimately, but those rules are adopted by several high courts. So today, the complaint is that the judiciary is really not transparent. There is a sea change in the executive and legislative branch of the state. Those information is available. I need not say anything about the scams, etc. You read papers every day. Right to information is a brahmastra in the hands of the Indian population. So I really feel that the RTI's regime, maybe it is not functioning fully satisfactorily. It's not broken. The Supreme Court should not have interfered and required that only judges can man this tribunal. We need to bring some transparency in the process of appointments. There is no doubt the bureaucracy's domination should be discouraged. It is also welcome that there should be high power committee for nominating the judges. There can be very socially conscious lawyers, there will be engineers, there will be architects who should come, and the most I welcome the younger generation to come and make it be proactive in these matters instead of handing this great institution in the hands of some retired judges. So thank you very much.